Did you know that with the right life philosophy, you can deal with any amount of pain for any amount of time? Did you know that an ancient Roman emperor accidentally wrote a Washington Post bestseller about it? Now, you're probably thinking, did he just say what I think he said? And yes, yes I did. In his personal journals entitled Meditations, Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius reveals the fruits of the ancient philosophy of Stoicism. Despite the fact that he wrote it a couple thousand years ago, never intended to publish it, and is obviously no longer with us, it still ended up on modern day bestseller lists. And it's not hard to see why. It's known as one of the definitive Stoic works. Throughout the text, Aurelius gives us his personal insights on using Stoicism to overcome any hardship and live a good life. In this video, we'll tell you what Stoicism is and how to use Aurelius's five pillars to live a life that's purposeful, meaningful, and free of suffering. Okay, so what's Stoicism? The central idea is that rational thinking can allow you to endure any hardship and allow you to endure any pain. Aurelius basically believes that we're here to live a good life, and that Stoicism supports that. A good life to Aurelius means two things: a purposeful life and a life that works for the common good. When you adopt a philosophy of Stoicism, you gain three valuable things that allow you to live a good life. Number one, the ability to endure any pain. You're able to recognize the ways you suffer for no reason, and how to release that unnecessary suffering. Number two, the ability to make grounded choices. You're able to react from logic and reason instead of emotions. This makes it possible for you to live your life in a conscious and deliberate way. Number three, the understanding that everything is interconnected. This allows you to see that everything in the universe has purpose, and that you have a responsibility as a part of the larger whole. Let's dive a little deeper into all this. Aurelius covers many topics, but there are five pillars that he always comes back to. Live by these pillars, and you can live the good life. Pillar number one is to remember and obey logos. This pillar is the heart of Stoicism. Logos is basically reason or order, and for Stoics, it's the force that guides the universe. According to most people who practice Stoicism, logos makes sure that everything that happens in the universe is balanced. This means we should accept that everything is as it should be. Every outcome is the best possible outcome for the health and prosperity of our world as a whole. Fun fact, human beings are the only life forms who have the free will to go against logos. Sounds pretty fun to be the exception, huh? Wrong! Stoicism sees this as the very thing that causes so much human suffering. According to Aurelius, all life forms exist to serve other life forms. Unfortunately, we humans often try to serve ourselves more than others, and this pushes the world out of harmony. We get into harmony when we accept that everything is as it should be, and is not meant to be resisted, and when we accept our responsibility for the common good. Pillar number two is to see things for what they are. Okay, Riddler, can you translate? Basically, you should be willing to see everything truthfully, even if it's not always exciting or nice. The observations you make should be reasonable and accurate, and you should always proceed with logic over emotion. For example, a five-star meal is just dead plants and animals. A crown on a king's head is just a piece of metal covered in rocks. Madonna's just some lady. Even the most powerful person in the world is still just some human being who will die like anyone else. Some of you are probably thinking, this kinda sounds like a joyless existence. And okay, yeah, it kinda does, right? But that's not the intention. It's not about taking the magic out of life. It's really just about not making things more than what they are. This is a really valuable strategy for coping with really confusing or painful experiences. For example, if a loved one gets sick, you'll probably be tempted to spiral into all kinds of fears about them getting worse or dying. And that's gonna cause you a lot of suffering. If you use this pillar, you don't have to suffer. You can stop your thoughts at "my loved one is sick" rather than spiraling into fears about them dying. Because right now, the only thing that's true is they're sick. Anything beyond that is not certain, and worrying about that causes unnecessary suffering. What happens when this gets really hard and you lose perspective? Try using the observe, judge, adapt rule. No matter what's happening, you always have access to judgment and adaptability. And these two things are at the core of rationality. If you lose perspective on a situation, first observe, evaluate the situation, then judge, see the truth of it, and finally, adapt. determine a new way to respond to it. This one is incredibly challenging to me because I am a huge worrywart. Like, when I moved to LA from Virginia, I spent so much time stressing about what I would do now that I couldn't just drive home in case of an emergency. But if I had just followed these rules, I could have saved myself a ton of anxiety. I could have observed that the only thing that changed was my location. I could have judged my situation and realized nothing bad has actually happened to anyone. Then finally, I could have realized that even though I am in a new place, all I have to do is adapt. I can check in with my family more, call them more often, and in the absolute worst case scenario, I can just catch a plane and fly home. Pillar number three is to recognize that outside forces can't hurt you. According to Aurelius, unendurable pain by definition ends itself.
Another riddler moment. I know.
Basically, he thinks that any pain you can't handle stops on its own. Because, well, you can't handle it. So you can technically endure any amount of physical or emotional pain for any amount of time. Let's just dive into that logic a little. He believes that the only thing that can hurt you is something that damages your mind or your character. That if something damages your body, it doesn't have to change you. It doesn't have to damage your mind or your character. So let your body worry about your body and give your mind a break. If you don't feel hurt physically, you don't have to be hurt at all.
I love emotional pain. I'm a theater boy.
Ow! Okay, that was physical pain and a little bit emotional because that was super embarrassing. Gosh. Anyway, painful emotions like anger and grief can and should be released because they'll harm you more than whatever provoked them. According to Stoicism, it's only your perception of what happens that creates the pain. So choose not to be harmed and you won't be. Maybe you're still thinking, hold on, what if someone does something truly horrible? How can you just let go of the hurt? Well, according to Aurelius, humans only make mistakes out of ignorance or accident. That means that if someone hurts you, they did it without meaning to, or because they didn't know any better. If you can recognize the humanity in them, you can meet their harm with compassion. It also helps remember that no person can truly damage your mind or your character unless you allow it. When you understand that no one can really hurt you, you can use compassion to forgive any harm done to you. Otherwise, the only alternative is blame, and blame sucks for everyone because it's just useless. If people only hurt people out of accident or ignorance, then what's the point of blaming them? It just causes more suffering. Here are some tips for rejecting anger and blame when it's tough to do so. When someone tries to hurt you, ask yourself why they've done so. Try to genuinely understand their reason. Did they intend to do harm? Did they intend to do good? Think deeply and notice if their sense of morality seems to be close to yours. If it does, you might excuse their actions as a mistake. If it doesn't, you can assume that they're misguided and deserve compassion. Remember that you've also made mistakes from accident or ignorance. Understand that everyone is capable of making the same mistakes. Be merciful towards others when they stumble and cause harm, and simply be more cautious with them in the future. See humanity as a big melting pot of opposites, where everything is there for a reason. Imagine the world from a bird's eye view. Understand that everyone has purpose and the world needs all types of people. Consider even embracing the possibility that there's a purpose to the hurt you feel you experience from others. Speaking of purpose, pillar number four is to live with purpose. Aurelius believes that purpose allows you to live well, and that remembering that you're part of a larger universe makes your purpose clearer. You can see the interconnectedness of everything. You understand the difference between selfish, petty actions or desires and the things that serve the common good. Aurelius has a very clear opinion on human purpose. He believes our purpose is to do good for others because we exist as a part of a larger whole. Being a tiny part of the larger universe means that individual desire is trivial and selfish. Accept your life as it is with grace and integrity and work towards the common good. Of course, some of us might see this as a little extreme, but being more grateful for what you already have is always a good thing to strive for. According to Aurelius, there are two simple steps for living a truly purposeful life. Number one, don't worry, be happy. Remember that everything is controlled by logos and everything in nature is aligned. You are not in control. You don't have to be, and you're not meant to be. And number two, stay focused. Remember that above all else, Your purpose is to be a good person that does good things for others. If this is a consistent priority, you will be living a life of true purpose. The final pillar, and arguably the most important, is to keep in mind that you will die one day. Not from a place of fear, because death is natural and necessary, but from a place of understanding that time is always running out. That understanding should inform all of your actions. Approach every task as if it's the last thing you'll ever do, and it's what you'll be remembered for. Here's some other tips for accepting death. Don't wish for a long life. According to Aurelius, there's no real benefit to living a long life. Whether you live 50 years or 5,000, everything you built will cease to exist the moment of your death. Also, since we're all gonna die, we should accept that with grace and realize that it doesn't really matter when it happens. It only matters that you're prepared to accept it when it does. And even the most magnificent of human lives is insignificant in the end. So why worry about life or death? Why even seek to live a magnificent life? Instead, you should just try to live a good life with dignity. Ease your passing. You can ease your passing by facing death. And you can face death by exploring what you cling to in life. Recognize that each thing you cling to is not something that you truly need. This will allow you to let go more peacefully when the time comes. If a fear of death comes up, observe what you're doing at that moment. Are you afraid you won't be able to do that thing anymore? Do you feel like you want to cling to it? Examine the fear and apply reason until it fades. If that doesn't work, you can always try to remind yourself that no matter how cool and awesome and successful you are, there's always gonna be at least one person who's happy to see you go. Come on, we all know someone. So in the worst case scenario, you can tell yourself that you're making someone else's life easier. You ever think about that? Take a bath. This is a bit of a random closing thought, but you can even use theater as a metaphor to process how you feel about death. Tragic plays exist to remind you of the things that can, and in the case of death, will happen to you. If you can endure watching them in a theater, you can accept them happening in real life. Imagine death as a curtain coming down at the end of a play. Actors don't get to decide how long the play is. The playwright already made that decision before they were even cast. When a play ends, the actors bow and they exit gracefully. Strive to live and die with the same grace. Living by the guidance of these five pillars is not easy, but at least there's only five of them. And if you apply them all, you can overcome anything life throws at you. Wow, well, we're done. That was cool. And a little confusing, wasn't it? Now listen to the wise and ancient Roman emperor and stop suffering! Just kidding. But seriously, I hope you feel like you got some helpful Stoicism tricks for navigating the rough stuff in life. Remember, when in doubt, don't worry and stay focused. This book has a lot of great insights into Stoicism that we didn't have time to cover today. If you're interested in going deeper, check out the Shortform Guide to Meditations. Shortform makes the world's best guides to nonfiction books, complete with well-crafted short exercises to help you learn faster and remember more. You can get a 5-day free trial and a discounted annual subscription if you go to shortform.com/YouTube. Click the link in the description below. And support the author and publisher by buying Meditations. A link to buy the book is below as well. And finally, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss the next short form video. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time.